Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I say Shabbat Shalom. I hope you are all having a blessed, peaceful, and safe day. Now, today's lesson is titled, Forgiven Sins, Lingering Consequences, because the lingering consequences is the thing that people don't pay attention to and don't focus on. They're more concerned about what they've done in the immediate and being forgiven of that or repenting of that. But we're going to focus on a bigger problem than just the sins we commit, the aftermath of what happens with some of them. And we're going to view this from the account of Abraham once again, because there are a lot of parallels in his life as compared to ours. So we're going to start in Genesis 21, and we're going to read verses 8 through 10. So go with me there. Verse 8 reads, "And the child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast the same day that Isaac was weaned. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, which she bore unto Abraham, mocking. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, Cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, even with Isaac." Now, by this time, Ishmael was a teenager, and Sarah observed him mocking his brother, Isaac, who was about 3 years old. But she was so fed up and she was so tired. This was yet another opportunity for her to express her displeasure with Hagar even being around. And this time she had had it. So she told Abraham to get rid of him. I want him out. Now, understand, when you mock, that means to make fun of someone or something in a cruel way, or to be derisive, or expressing contempt or ridicule. And that's what Ishmael was doing to his younger brother. So Sarah had enough, and she said it's time for him to go. Now, this kind of stuff grieved Abraham, but the father told him how to handle it. So as we go on, remember a couple of things. One, the Almighty keeps his promises. And two, he forgives us of our sins. Now, in our relationship with the Father, many of us spend a lot of time on that roller coaster of doing right and committing sin, doing right and committing sin. Many of us end up regretting these transgressions, and we go to the Father asking for forgiveness. Many of us claim repentance to do what? To only turn around and do the same thing all over again. Now, the reason why many of us even go to the Father and seek forgiveness for our transgressions is because we believe the word. We believe what 1 John 1:9 tells us. And it simply reads like this. It says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." And we believe this, so we go to him when we mess up. But many of us who truly commit to the Father's word, we tend to ride this same roller coaster less and less as we grow, as we become wiser, as we become more mature. We tend to ride it less and less because we become that much more devoted, and we really strive to work toward that perfectness in him that we should have. And it's a process. It's something that we grow into. And we start to understand as we grow that we want to be perfect in him to bring glory and honor to him, because he is worthy of that. One thing to keep in mind is that most of us fail to realize that no matter what we do, there are always consequences. And some of those consequences may linger on and on and on beyond any magnitude that we may have even thought they could. But we have to keep that in mind. We also must remember, although we may be forgiven for our sins, what's done is done. And there is a price that's going to be paid. In our lives, in our children's lives, husband, family members, somebody, the price is going to be paid. And some of these prices are not worth the pain that you or others end up going through. So we have to consider these things before we even commit some of these sins that we do. Although the Father may have forgiven us of our sins, we may have already set in motion some things that are going to bring great pain later on in life. And sadly, some of these sins can bring death later on, and you will have no idea where it stemmed from. You'll just be broken, sad, and hurt that some tragedy has happened to some family member, some friend, or what have you. Sin has a price to pay. We don't get away with anything scot-free. And that means we don't get away without suffering any punishment or injury. Something's going to happen, but you just don't know when. And you may have long forgotten the sin that brought it upon you. Now, here are some examples. Drugs and alcohol. They can cause you to lose employment. They can cause you to lose your family, wife, children, relations, what have you. It can cause loss of life. You could be involved in an accident and kill others. Anger issues, lashing out at loved ones, physically attacking individuals, friends, family, loved ones, whomever. Cruel, harsh words that you speak because of anger issues, all these types of things. So remember, in spite of being forgiven by individuals, sometimes there are lingering consequences of things that everyone doesn't recover from. There can be permanent mental or physical bruises left on individuals whom you victimized. There can be broken relationships, and some of those relationships are altered forever. And these are just some of the things that may result, although you have been forgiven by individuals or by the Father, as long as you handle this in the right order. Because remember, you cannot go straight to the Father seeking forgiveness for individuals you have wronged. You must go to them to make that atonement first. Matthew 8:15 reads, it says, "Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother." See, this scripture tells us that we must labor in agreement. We must labor in agreement. We can't just go bypass the situation straight to the Father and seek forgiveness and it's over and done with. We have to go to the individual first. This scripture also shows us that we set ourselves up to have to learn humility when we are wrong or do wrong things toward other people. And those who can't humble themselves to get through what Matthew 18:15 says are doing nothing more than demonstrating that they have an issue with pride. They are full of pride, arrogance, and their own haughtiness. They can't get by that because they're stuck on being who they are. But that's my next lesson. Now, let's consider one very powerful example that I'm going to talk about, which I know is going to strike at the emotions of so many of you. But mind you, the Father speaks about this type of thing, and it's very important that we understand there are some lingering consequences sometimes that people never get over. I've seen it, a lot of you are living it, and a lot of you will never get over it. And that is what? The topic of abortion. When I was preparing this study, the thought came into my head to mention this topic because of things like the lingering consequences that plague so many of you out here, and it does till this very day, for something you may have done years and years ago, and you will never get over it until your death. So this is a very important point to place some emphasis on because it is such a powerful parallel and reference point that so many of you can relate to. Now, the Father has no debate about conception or the beginning of life. He takes two simple but complex forms of life to create a greater form of life to his power and glory. But see, as always, the enemy comes along and creates a perversion as always and says that this creation is not life until X amount of weeks, months, or whatever down the road. And he has sold this bill of goods to the world to create a controversy, to create confusion, to create conflict. And everyone has bought into it. Now, consider Mary, the mother of our Savior, for instance. Luke 1:35 reads like this, starting with 34. "Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" She was a virgin, simple and clear. 35. "And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God." Now, how did we get from the power of the Almighty bringing these two lesser lives together, instantly creating a greater one to the point of willfully violating Exodus 20:13? And for those who don't know, it says, "Thou shalt not kill." Mankind has been beguiled, like I said, once again by the enemy into questioning what the Almighty Himself has said, has written in stone. Just like He beguiled Eve, He tricked her, He got her thinking in her own mind. And this is the same thing He has done to mankind on this subject. See, the Marys of today question the Father's word or don't even think about it at all and willfully violate His law. Because what? Because it's convenient for the most part, because of whom? The enemy. They have played into what the enemy feeds. At a sadder point in this, so many out here willfully do this as a choice of convenience or as a form of birth control itself. And that's the sadness in this, because you repeat this process over and over and over, as many do, and it is a terrible transgression against the Almighty and His word. Now, my point is that even in this type of transgressing, He will forgive us. The Father will forgive us, but we must understand that some sins have lingering consequences and effects on our lives that may last forever. See, many of you are living with these demons every day and still haven't overcome them, so you can sorrowfully relate to what I'm saying. But compare this plight of yours to the transgression of even King David himself, and draw the parallels and see how his willful transgression against others brought him much pain and suffering to no end, and it carried on into future generations of his. Now we're going to go to 2 Samuel 12:1-8, but before we get there, quickly, this is what David did. David, king at the time, saw another man's wife, Bathsheba, whom he desired, and he called upon her, and he took of her, and in that she became pregnant. Now, in the meantime, Bathsheba's husband, Uriah, one of King David's soldiers, was out in the field fighting a war. So once Bathsheba became pregnant and she informed David, he panicked. Now, in those days, adultery was worthy of being stoned to death. So David panicked. He devised a plan in his own mind of how to get out of the situation. So he had Uriah called in from the field and spent some time with him, and he tried to encourage him to go home to be with his wife, so to speak. But Uriah refused because he was sympathetic to the plight of his fellow soldiers out there and refused to entertain himself with the pleasures of a woman, his wife, while his soldiers were out fighting. So he refused to do that, and he went back to the field. So David panicked even farther. So in the process of all this, what he did was give Uriah a message to Joab to help fix his problem. Now, the message that King David gave to Uriah to give to Joab, his general, instructed General Joab to put Uriah the Hittite into the most hostile zone there was, because King David understood that this would probably bring to Uriah his death, and that would resolve his problem. Which it did occur that way. Uriah ended up being killed, and David's problem was solved. Now, over the next few months, this grieved him because he knew he had done wrong. But nonetheless, he lived with it until 2 Samuel 12:1-8. And this is where Nathan the prophet appeared. Now I'm going to read these right quick. So follow me with the parable that Nathan subscribed to David, starting with verse 1, 2 Samuel 12. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children, It did eat of his own meat and drink of his own cup, and lay in his bosom, and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take his own flock and his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was coming to him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to Nathan, "As the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing, and because he had no pity." And Nathan said to David, "Thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and delivered thee out of the land of Saul. And I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would moreover have given unto thee such and such things." See, David knew what he was doing, and the Almighty called him out on it. He had the audacity to send a suicide note with Uriah to have him killed to help resolve his issue. David was being selfish and only thinking about himself. See, he panicked. Many of us think about ourselves and we fall right into transgression. See, David committed an indirect act of murder, but he knew what he was doing. And like I said, the father used Nathan to call him out on what he had done so he could really realize what he had done. Now, even in all this, verse 13 shows us something. Let's go to verse 13. It reads, it says, "And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, The Lord hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die." Did you hear what he said? He said, "The Lord hath put away thy sin, and thou shalt not die." So was David forgiven? Most certainly he was, because like I said, that was worthy of being stoned to death, what he had done. The adultery, and then having Uriah killed by his own hand, so to speak. But verses 14, 15, and 18 give a chilling account of some everlasting consequences. Verse 14 reads, "Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. And Nathan departed unto his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died." David was truly blessed by the Father to be forgiven by such a terrible thing he had done. But there are some telling results and some lingering results of what David did, and he would live with them through the rest of his life. Now, go with me to verse 9. Verse 9 reads like this, and this is what we need to pay attention to when we commit transgressions against the Father and His Word and feel that much more comfortable once we go to Him to seek forgiveness and understand that He does forgive us of our sins. There are some lingering consequences that will plague many of us for the rest of our days. Go with me to verse 9. It reads, "Wherefore thou hast despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in His sight. Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbor, and shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. For thou didst it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." Now, some of you don't know the story because you haven't read the word. Here are a couple of things that happened in David's life with that sword never being removed from his own household. One of his own sons raped his daughter. And King David never handled that situation correctly because it was his own child. So he suffered grief and anguish beyond that. One of his other sons wanted to take his kingdom, so much that he strove to have his father killed to take his kingdom, and David had to flee before he could get his kingdom back. David had all sorts of problems in his household because of his sin. But unlike us, I guarantee you, David understood why he was suffering the things he suffered. Remember, he had Nathan, a prophet, there too, who constantly advised him about things. So David was well aware of what he was doing and why he was suffering a lot of the things that he suffered. But yet, in all of this, the Father blessed him and he loved King David. And remember, he said that he was a man after his own heart. So David truly repented and became a beacon of light for the Father. But he committed some sins that caused lingering problems that never left his household throughout his own life. So King David's family suffered the results of lingering consequences of transgressions. Now, all of this takes us all the way back to Genesis 21, to where we started. Abraham and Sarah lived with the results of their transgressions of being disobedient and impatient with the Almighty. But they also passed some of these lingering results all the way down to even the year 2014, even to this very day at this very moment. Now, some of you have no idea what I'm about to say, but if you study and if you understand lineages and where some of these things come from, it will slap you right in the face. Because Ishmael was the seed of Abraham, the father kept his promise, and thus Ishmael was blessed too and became a mighty nation, as the father said he would. For those of you who don't know, Ishmael is the father of the Arab nation, and this is where Islam comes from. Thus, this is where the terrorists of today come from. They are descendants of Ishmael, the child of Abraham. And see, some of you don't understand that our sins can have far-reaching consequences, even more so than we could ever imagine. This is 2014. This was thousands of years ago, but it has made it all the way up to today. So understand that when you commit sins and your children commit sins, and those before you have committed sins, relatives, mothers, fathers, grandparents, whatever, you never know how far-reaching these transgressions are going to be and the problems they cause. So be very careful of the things we do, because some of them have long-lasting effects for future generations. But with all that, never doubt that the Father will forgive us of our transgressions. But also remember that the effects of some sins are not erasable. And with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.